Thank you very much, Gwen. And hello again from our side. Yes, welcome to our webinar, OpenAPC Cost and Transparency of Open Access Publishing today. And as Gwen said, we have some rules. If you have questions, we have a Q&A section. So in the last couple minutes of this webinar, we will answer some questions from your side. The speaker today is my colleague Christoph Brusinski. He is a member of the DFG funded project Intact, and this starts in 2015. And Christoph shares his knowledge about APCs, open APCs, gold access of open access, gold open access publishing, and he's an expert in the field of processing charges. So my name is Andreas Czerniak. I'm the project officer of OpenAIR at Bielefeld University and responsible for the work package of OpenAIR. Short words about OpenAIR. OpenAIR is stands for Open Access Infrastructure for Research in Europe, and was funded in 2009 from the European Commission, and has around about 55 institutions in the European countries and beyond. OpenAIR collaborates with projects like OpenAPC, also ERC, eInfra Central, and many, many more organizations. So I will take the floor over to Christoph, and here's the link for your floor.
Well, yes, thank you very much, Andreas. And also for me, a very warm welcome to this small webinar we are going to hold. A small warning in advance. I've been feeling a bit sick in the last week. And well, sorry in advance for any sneezings or coughings. I'm probably getting on your nerves with in the future, but I'm trying to mute them away as good as I can. All right. My part of this presentation is named Transparency of Publication Fees and the OpenAPC Project. And I'm going to talk about our part of the OpenAPC Project. First, for a little introduction, what is OpenAPC in a nutshell? Well, if you want to put it on one line, OpenAPC is an open data project, and it's tasked with the collection, processing, and dissemination of data on APC expenditures. I'm sure that most of you are already familiar with this, but I think it can't be too bad to for a short reminder on what APCs are. APC is an abbreviation for article processing charge. And an APC is a one-time fee, which is to be paid to a publisher if you want to have an article published in an open access scientific journal. And this fee can either be mandatory in case it's a fully open access journal, or it can be optional in case it's a hybrid open access journal. In the latter case, you can decide as an author if you want to pay an APC. And if you do, your article will be accessible as open access. And if you don't, the article will stay closed and it will only be accessible in a traditional way via journal subscription. And if we talk about how high is the average APC, well, it's usually in the 1,000 to 3,000 euro range. The average value we record in our OpenAPC data set is slightly below 2,000 euros. And this brings us right to the second question: why are APCs important? Well, I think you all know that that we are right in the middle of a great transition process. The scientific publishing is slowly but steadily shifting to open access. And that means at the same time that the payments which are done in this whole field, the payments from institutions and libraries to publishers, they are also transforming mostly from subscription fees to APC-based models. And this is why APCs are important, because there are really big amounts of money at stake. I think some of you who have a library background will be familiar with how big these sums are, which are changing hands year to year in subscription fees. And these big amounts of money, they are now transforming to APC-based models. And what are the benefits of making these APC transactions accessible as open data, which is what we are doing in the Open APC project? There are two arguments there. The first one is some kind of a large-scale argument. It's policy making, because there's a lot of research and education policy going around this transition process. For example, you might have heard of the big DEAL project we are doing in Germany here right at the moment. It's a deal which the institutions are having negotiated with the publisher Wiley. And all these things revolving around this transition process, they need a solid data background. So monitoring and steering of this transition process requires data on these APC payments. And there's also a kind of a small scale argument, because in practice, these APC amounts, they're often negotiable. Which means if you as an author go ahead and have to pay an APC because you want to publish an open access article, you can often go to the publisher and say, oh, well, I really can't pay that much. Can't we just negotiate the APC amount? And surprisingly, this often works. And as it is with all negotiations, if you have information, information is power. And it can really strengthen your position in this kind of publisher negotiations if you know what other institutions have paid for their APCs. All right, now for some facts and numbers. As Andreas already said, our project was established in mid-2014 here at Bielefeld University Library. Our first participants were German universities, which took part in the open access publishing program of the DFG, that's the Deutsche Forschungsgemeinschaft, German Research Society. And our project also was officially funded by the DFG from 2015 to 2018 under the name INTACT. And since 2018, we are funded by the BMBF, the Federal Ministry of Education and Research here in Germany, under the project name COA. And well, what are our rules, our basic principles? Our first and foremost principle is that we want to apply a maximum of transparency. This word open, in our mind, it should not only apply to the data, but also to things like the code, the workflow, or the whole project history. We see in a moment how we are trying to achieve that. We also employ a high degree of automation. For example, we use lots of scripting and programming languages for the data enrichment, for testing, and for building. And we also try to lay the entry barriers very low for new participants. For example, there's no such thing as a formal membership in OpenAPC. You just have to submit data to us, and basically then you're a member of our project. Let's have a look at the current state of OpenAPC as of October 2019. Our metadata collection now consists of almost 85,000 articles with associated APC costs. They have been contributed by 247 institutions from 16 different countries. And the total reported APC amount, if you sum together all the articles present in our data set, amounts to 160 million euros. So you can easily see that it's correct what I said before. There's really a lot, a big amount of money at stake in all this scholarly publishing. And this money is now transferring or transforming from subscription fees to APCs. Now to go a bit more into the details about our data format and our data processing. All the data we have collected in OpenAPC is stored in a very simple table format. It's a simple CSV file, comma separated value. And what's interesting is that our data file consists of 18 metadata fields, but only 5 of them are mandatory when you're reporting data to OpenAPC. That's because the remaining metadata is automatically imported from external sources. Let's have a more close look at that. What we can see here, this table, that's what our metadata format looks like. And only these 5 fields on the left-hand side, we can see here in orange, these are the fields you have to report to as an institution if you want to take part in OpenAPC. What we can see here is, of course, well, the institution name, that's Bamberg University in this case, the period the APC in question was paid. Then, of course, the most important metadatum is the euro amount, that's the APC. Then also very important, the DOI. Every article you submit to us should have a DOI because a DOI is very important for the following metadata enrichment process. And the last one is an identifier, a Boolean value is hybrid. This indicates if the journal this article was published in is a hybrid or a fully open access journal. And all the remaining metadata fields on the right-hand side, those are inferred automatically from external sources. For example, the blue fields we see here, we import them from CrossRef via the DOI. For example, the publisher name, the journal title, several ISSN values, and a license ref, a license identifier. Then we have 2 values we are importing from EuroPubMed Central, the PubMed ID and the PubMed Central ID. Then the ISSNL, that's the so-called linking ISSN. It's a general identifier issued also by the ISSN organization, which links together, so to say, the first 3 ISSN values. It's important for certain bibliographical analysis. Then we have the UT, that's the Web of Science article identifier. We are important, obviously, from the Web of Science. And the last one is this DOIJ identifier. It's also a Boolean value. And it tells if the journal in question is listed in the DOIJ, the Directory of Open Access Journals. And this approach has a lot of advantages. The first one is, of course, it means that there's less work for participants. You really have to submit only these 5 first fields to us. And all the other ones you don't have to care about because we do that for you, importing them from external sources. The second advantage is that this process leads to unified publisher and journal designations because, as you can see, we import the publisher name and the journal full title from CrossRef. So that means that those designations are unified. If every institution would fill out these fields for themselves, of course, you would can easily see that we would import a lot of heterogeneity in the data, and that's what we don't want. So importing this from CrossRef is very advantageous. And the third one is, of course, that corrections can be applied retroactively. From time to time, we'll repeat this enrichment process also for the articles we already have in our data set. And if any corrections, for example, there's another ISSN number, for example, because the first one was wrong in CrossRef, then we will get these corrections automatically into our data set. Okay, let's talk a bit more about our OpenAPC infrastructure. What's important to note is that we are using Git for maintaining our data, and we are publishing it on GitHub. Some of you might be familiar with this. Git is an a code revision system. It's usually used for software development, but as it turned out, it's also very useful for maintaining an open data project. We can take a look at our GitHub repository. What we can see here, this is actually all the data we are currently maintaining in OpenAPC, and we are using this Git repository to share it with other people and for maintaining this open data approach. We can have a look at it. We have this README file, this index front plate here. As we can see, there's a lots of participants already in OpenAPC. We're listed in here. And we also have some tables and plots here about our data. But what's really interesting is this folder structure here, because that's really where the data is. We have this data folder here. And what we can see here is a folder for all our participating institutions. And that's where you can find the CSV tables they have submitted to us. And what we can also see here, scrolling down here, the APCDE file, that's our data collection. So the APCDE file, that's where all our data is stored. I'm showing it you in a text editor because if I would open it here, it would take some moments because it has reached a size of about, I think, 12 megabytes. So easier to view it here. Well, and as you can see, well, CSV file, very easy file format. And it's a really large file of almost 85,000 articles. Large, large, large. Okay, and what's also very interesting about Git and GitHub is that it automatically keeps a history. Every action which changes or submits new data is a so-called commit in Git, and we can see all the commits listed here. So there were almost 4,300 points in time where data was changed or added in our repository. And what's really cool is that we can list all these commits here, and we can also see what has happened in these commits. So for example, we can just, well, let's click onto this one. And now we see what was changed in this commit. For example, here, this was a small correction. This door here was with an uppercase. And in OpenAPC, we only want lowercase letters in the doors. That's a convention we apply. So this was before in the red line. The green line tells us how it was after the commit. So and this commit, they form a sort of a commit chain. If we want, we can go back really to the start of the project in 2014 when this repository was founded, and can see all the changes which were actively trace them back and see what has happened over time in the OpenAPC project. So that's what I meant when I talked about that we are also applying the open data principle to our project history. And what we also do, we have this Python directory, the programming language Python, and that's where we store all the scripts we use, for example, for testing or enriching our data. It's all also open data. In this case, it's software, so it's more called open source. And that's what we mean when we're applying this open data principle also to our software and scripts. All right, then we are also operating our OpenAPC project blog. We can also have a look at this one. Whenever an institution makes a new data submission to us, we are preparing a blog post. Let's have a look at the last one. This was Virginia Tech from the US. reporting their 2017 and 2018 APC expenditures to us. And well, there's some general information. And for example, the last commit by Virginia Tech, they submitted 145 articles to us with a certain lump sum and average fee. And you can see a table of all the publishers which were involved in this APC summary, and some plots also, a nice tree map, and some plots about the average cost for the Virginia Tech, for example. That's a nice thing because it disseminates better the data about our participants, what they're doing, and what data they are submitting to us. And the last thing I want to show you is our interactive tree map graphics. That's actually what perhaps OpenAPC is most famous for, because these tree map graphics, they're often referenced. The site we're operating is treemaps.intechproject.org. And we have small tree map visualizations, first for all our participants, but there's also an aggregated view. That's what I'm opening now. And this is actually an interactive tree map. So we can use it to view and to delve into our data. For example, we can change the hierarchy. At the moment, we are looking at the institution branch. So the tree map is sorted by institutions, but we can also change the view. Now we are looking at the publishers. For example, for Elsevier, we have 32 million euros in APC in our data set. For Springer Nature, we have a bit less. For Wiley, for PLOS, and so on. And we can also change this, for example, to the journal, or we get a really a really colorful tree map. That's the distribution over all the different journals. And as I said before, we can really use this to explore and to delve into the data, because, for example, let's change back to the institutional view. If we, let's say, we want to examine the University of Cambridge, then we can just click on this Cambridge rectangle. And then we go down another level, and now we see how this lump sum for Cambridge distributes over all the journals, Cambridge has published and paid APCs for and reported to us. And we can do the same again. For example, we want to examine the journal Nature Communications. Then we click onto this rectangle, and then we get down to the last level, to the level of individual articles. Now we see all the articles, the APC was paid for them. And we can also, if we want, we can even click on this link here. It's a DOI link, so we can even get to the article text. There are some other options. We can also filter the tree map, for example. We can filter it to certain periods, or let's say we only want to observe a certain hybrid status, for example, only the journals published in open access, all the articles published in open access journals, or all the articles published in hybrid journals. And we can also filter, for example, for different countries. And if we have found a view we want to examine more deeply, we can also download the current view we are looking at via this button. We can download it either as a CSV or a JSON file. All right, now becoming part of OpenAPC, because at least in part what this webinar is about. We want to encourage you to also send data to us if you're working, for example, at a university or library, which is also paying APCs. So let's say your institution wants to participate in OpenAPC, what steps do we have to undertake? Well, the first one is, of course, you would have to prepare an additional data set according to our submission guidelines. It's also defined here in our GitHub wiki. It's important to note that this initial data set doesn't have to be large. We have participants which are only contributing perhaps 5 articles per year, And that's perfectly in order. So you don't have to be Cambridge University and and submit hundreds and hundreds of APC transactions per year. There's an option to create a small README file, which would provide some background information to you and your institution. You can do that, but you don't have to. You would have to designate a contact person at your institution, just a name and a mail address. So we know who to contact if there is anything going on with your data, if there are any problems. Then you would mail everything to our project address, openapc@unibielefeld.de. And well, that's it. And we would then go ahead, check your data, enrich it, publish it in our OpenAPC GitHub, and then you're basically a member of OpenAPC. If you're feeling a bit more adventurous or you have people which are more technically inclined at your institution, you might also want to consider doing a pull request on GitHub. We won't go into this in any more detail, and that's really a bit for the more for the tech people. And there's another way of contributing which I want to mention here, because if I see this correctly in our audience, there might be some people which are dealing with institutional repositories, so this might be of some interest to you. We have two participants which have done this already. They went ahead and modified their institutional repository so that the APC costs were directly attached as metadata to their article records. And then they went ahead and told us the relevant parameters. And now we are going to them and harvest the metadata automatically in regular intervals via the OAI PMH protocol. And that's very interesting because it effectively reverses the flow of communication. It's not longer you which are sending mails with CSV files to us, but it's us coming to you and obtaining the data from your institutional repository. So it lessens the burden on you, so to say. And well, that's very convenient for both sides. And I want to show you a small example, because Regensburg University, the ePrints people there, they have already done this. And we can have a small look at the OAI response from the EPUB server at Regensburg. As we can see here, that's the response format. And here, that's the important point, of course. They have attached the APC, which was paid for this article in question, directly to the metadata, which is delivered by their institutional repository server. All right, but really, that's only a small thing I wanted to show you. It's a very, very advanced, of course. And if you're just our everyday participant, you would just go ahead and send us an email with the attached CSV file. So now we want to talk a bit, of course, about the benefits of taking part in OpenAPC. Because we talked a lot about what you have to do if you want to be a participant, but you might, of course, go ahead and ask, well, what are our benefits? What we gain as an institution if we participate and send you our APC transaction data? Of course, the first one I can offer is a warm, cozy feeling of doing the right thing, because it's an open data project, and open data, it's, of course, cool and the good side, and so on and so on and so on. But well, I can understand if you want something more than that. So the first benefit I can offer you is our testing routines, because I already mentioned that all data which is contributed to OpenAPC is automatically checked by a test routine. For example, we do, of course, if we say we, it's of course a programming script. We don't do this manually. We do consistency tests. If two records share the same ISSN, they must also have identical publisher and journal names, because same ISSN, same journal. There are things like logical tests. For example, if a journal is listed in the DOAJ, then this hybrid metadata field must be false, because it is known that the DOAJ only lists fully open access journals. We also do some content checking. We take the DOI and check if it's syntactically correct and if it does resolve, which is of course very important for DOI. And we also do duplicate checks. We check if a DOI does appear more than once in our OpenAPC dataset. If it does, it's an error because that's per convention, our OpenAPC dataset must be completely duplicate free. And well, if we encounter any errors during this testing, we go ahead and report them back to you as an institution. And this can be helpful in several ways for you. For example, if we find any malformed DOIs, we will report this to you and then you can correct them, because if we report malformed DOIs to us, it's likely that they are also malformed in your institutional accounting system, backend repository, whatsoever, because usually DOIs aren't touched anywhere in the data processing. If we encounter any non-resolving DOIs during our tests, we also report them to you. And then you would usually go ahead and report this to the publishers, because they are usually responsible for properly registering their DOIs with the agencies. And if we encounter any DOI duplicates, this may point to actually quite serious data errors if they appear within the same institution. And sometimes we even have cases where these duplicates occur within different institutions. And this might actually point to accounting errors or even to fraud. And that's actually not great theory, because we already had those cases. We had cases of publishers double charging. So they wrote two receipts for the same institution. Or we had a case of an author applying for full APC funding at more than one institution and putting the rest of the money in its own pocket, which was, of course, a case of fraud. And these cases were discovered because OpenAPC did this duplicate checking within their framework. And the second benefit for you is our system of report generation. You will receive an individual data report from us upon every contribution. This is an automatically generated PDF document. And it is meant to discover pointers to possibly flawed APC amounts, because this first section here, the testing, that's more on the on hard errors, we like to call it, because for example, malformed DOIs or wrong ISSNs, these are all hard metadata errors. They are easy to spot and easy to correct. But looking at the APC amounts and telling if an APC amount is possibly wrong or unusually, that's much more difficult. And what we do is that we try to apply statistical measures, and we report back those APCs to you which diverge more than two standard deviations from the calculated mean. Standard deviation, you might know that, is a standard statistical measure to identify outliers in a data set or unusual amounts. And this is more the soft testing, because the results are not necessarily errors, they're statistical outliers, as I just said. So it's up to you to look at them and decide if there's really something wrong with the APC amount. And I can show you one of these reports I've just generated for University of Bielefeld. This is what it looks like. As I said, it's a really easy APC, PDF document. There's some general data here, some structural data. And what we can see here, that's the important section. This is where we list all the articles where we discovered an outlier, or where we discovered that the APC amount we reported to us diverges more than two standard deviations from the mean. For example, this is an article here. It was published in the journal Cell Reports by Elsevier. And it was in 2018. Here's the DOI. And Bielefeld reported an APC cost of 2,100 euros. And as you can see here, the MV, the mean value, So that's the mean value for this journal cell reports we have in our OpenABC dataset is 4,400 euros. So there's a difference of 2,300 euros. The University of Bielefeld paid less for this article. And of course, that's a very interesting case. And I mentioned this right at the start of my presentation, that APCs are negotiable. And we know this because we have actually talked to the author of this paper. And this was really a case of negotiation, because here at Bielefeld University, we have our institutional publication fund operating. And this fund has an upper limit of what it pays for individual APCs. And our upper limit is 2,000 euros. And what this particular author did, he just got in contact with Elsevier and just said, well, I want to publish this article open access, but 4,400 euros, that's just too much for me. I can only pay 2,000 because that's what our institutional fund will repay for me. Well, and some negotiation went ahead, and well, in the end, they agreed to APC amount of 2,000 euros. So that's actually a good example of how of what a margin there is with APC amount. There is really a margin for negotiation. And well, there are other cases here of articles which are outliers or which are somewhat unusual. But as I said, we cannot really say that these are errors. These are just statistical outliers, and we are just reporting them back to you as an institution, so you may have a second look at them. And well, this is overview here. As you can see, most of the articles, of course, are not deviating much. They are not significant in statistical terms. With Bielefeld, we had 491 articles, which were not deviating much, and we had only significantly deviating 6 articles. So this report is something you, as a document, you will get also on every data contribution to OpenAPC. All right, we are nearing the end of my presentation. Now I want to talk shortly about some applications, because OpenAPC is maintaining an open data set, and with all data, data gets stronger the more you combine it with more data. And there were also already some projects where the OpenABC data set could be used by combining it with other data. For example, we had a very interesting analysis here at Bielefeld University. We are also operating the National Open Access Contact Point here for Germany. And the people at the contact point, they conducted an analysis by combining the OpenABC data set with a data set on journal impact metrics, the so-called SNIP or SNP factor. And what I wanted to examine is if there is a relation between impact factors and APC amounts. And you might guess there is. Journals with a higher impact factor, which are more prestigious, they also levy higher APCs. Who would have guessed that? We also combined our OpenAPC data set with publisher provided data. In that case, it was the open access publisher Frontiers. With that, we could measure the effectiveness of the mentioned DFG publication funds by comparing the publisher data with the reported data. So we could see what share of articles which are funded by this publication funds is reported by the publisher itself. And we also conducted some bibliometrical analysis by combining data we obtained from the Springer web portal, Springer Link, to estimate the effects of certain transitional agreements. I'll not go into more detail here. If you're interested in that, you might have a look at this slides after this presentation, and then you can click the links all for yourself. So yeah, I think that's for my part. Now Andreas will go ahead, and I think he will demonstrate Another kind of OpenAPC data combination, a combination between OpenAIR and OpenAPC data. So now I am, sorry, that's for later. I am giving the mic to back to Andreas.
Thank you very much, Christoph. your great overview about the OpenAPC project and the benefits of the institutions of via the OpenAPC project. So I will talk about another possible reuse or use of these data in OpenAIR. OpenAIR has a lot of funder informations and funding informations. So in the first case, we integrate these OpenAPC data set in OpenAIR and found a coverage of 98% based on the DOIs from the OpenAPC data set in the OpenAIR graph, research graph. So there's an average of less of 2,000 euros. And as Christoph said, more than 160 million euros in the OpenAPC data set. We have taken a look into the OpenAPC data set and found and related to the funders. And here you can show, you can see the major funders that we found in our data set. It's the Wellcome Trust has more than 10,000 articles and an average of 2,500 euros and so on. This can also be combinated to the funder programs. Here's the three major programs. The FP7 was actually more than 5,000 articles. We found an average of more than 2,000 euros in this case. So there are many, many more relations between the OpenAPC data set and the OpenAIR research graph. And we actually integrate the OpenAPC data sets on the release dates from GitHub into the OpenAIR research graph, and we'll present these information in our community dashboards or in the Explore dashboards. You will see, you can see the OpenAIR portal. This information was also present in the development API for integrating these informations into your applications. So you can go to api.openair.eu, and we will also present the APC or the processing charges in this case at on the level of the programming interface. As Christoph mentioned, so we also suggest that repository developers are include these APCs or BPCs, these processing charges into the repository software. So that could be harvested automatically via OEP image interface. And this is very nice to have. Use case at the moment, but it could be possible to have this in the future. So I would like to come to the end of this webinar. We have a question during the webinar. I think this was before Christoph come to the benefits of the OpenAPC project. And we have another question here from Thomas. How do you register APCs with or without FAT?
Okay, I think I can step in here, and because I think all these questions are more or less directed to me. Andreas, can you? Yeah, thank you. Okay. Well, I think the first question was, what are the main reasons institutions refuse to join your initiative or provide the data? What I can say from my point of view is that this might come as a surprise, but most often it's not for political reasons. You might think that institutions would be hesitating to publish APCs because it's their financial data. It's from their wholly internal workings and accounting systems. But actually, that's not the case often. It's more often that institutions want to participate and contribute data, but they aren't able to. And the reason is that for compiling these OpenAPC tables for us, they have to bridge a gap between two different worlds. And the two different worlds I'm talking to here about here is the world of libraries and of metadata. That's the world of DOIs and publisher titles and journal titles and ISSNs. And on the other hand, it's the world of financial and institutional accounting, where the invoices, for example, they receive from the publishers, they are stored in for example in accounting systems. And bridging the gap between these two worlds, and they have to do this to bring them together, because they have to assign a DOI on the other hand to an APC amount on the other hand. And that's actually the most important obstacle. From our point of view, many institutions are really willing to contribute to OpenAPC, but it's this gap that holds them up. Bringing together APCs and bibliographical data. That's the obstacle which is hindering them. I hope this answers your question. Then we have a question from Thomas Messerschmidt. Hello, I'd like to ask, how do you register APCs with or without VAT? Very good question. In general, in OpenAPC, we are interested in the final sum. This means that we want APCs with VAT, value added tax, and also with any discounts, for example. So, for example, there are institutions which are receiving discounts from certain publishers because they are they're operating a membership, for example, with certain research societies. And we also like to that these kind of discounts included into the final price. Someone else is sharing. Could you give me back the screen perhaps? Then I can show you. Thank you. I can show you our data submission endout I showed you briefly before. We also have a section on definition of costs. That's actually how we liked this sum in the Euro metadata field, how we would like it to have calculated. And as you can see here, It really starts with all reported publication fees are gross values. Modifiers like taxes or discounts should be included into the amount. And I said it's a good question because the initial definition, what is an APC? As it turned out during the course of our project, it's not so clear as it might be at first glance. Because if you look at the other bullet points here, for example, what is the matter with page or color charges? Because even in the age of mostly electronic publishing, there are still publishers which levy page and color charges. Because, well, I don't know, because colorful electrons are more expensive than gray electrons or something like that. And what about, for example, corrigenda? When you when you have to make a correction or addition to your article, then there's also a fee to pay. Is this fee part of the initial initial APC? We say it isn't because the APC it's not part really of the APC. It's an addition which comes later. And you really have to have a look at this definition of costs if you provide data to us. Because that's actually that's the most important thing, that we get a common definition of APCs in our data set, because otherwise it would the amounts would be indeed hard to they would be hard to compare. Okay, then we have another question. Do you include or collect information on the special agreements institutions have with publishers, for example like MDPI? No, we don't do that. Well, the short answer is that we do not want our APC dataset to be cluttered with metadata fields, so to say. Of course, you could argue that we should introduce additional fields to mark certain circumstances this article was published under. For example, as you say in your question, because there was a special agreement with MDPI, which gives a certain discount to the institution, for example. But we decided against it because we want to keep our metadata compatible over the course of time. And we do not want to introduce fields which would have no value for most of the entries. So if there is, let's say, an agreement with MDPI, we encourage our institutions to give information about these circumstances in the README file. I mentioned this briefly in my presentations. Institutions can add a README file to their institutional folder. I think we can have a look at that. Let's see if I find the institution where that's the case. I think Dresden University is doing that. Yes. As you can see here, Dresden University, they have an agreement with MDPI, and they are giving some information on that in this README file, which is attached to their institutional data directory. So, it's not a really gold solution. We are aware of that because this kind of information is free text, so it's not machine processable. But I think it's still preferable to really cluttering our metadata set with lots of additional fields dealing with certain circumstances which can occur when paying APCs. Okay, I hope this answers your question. Yeah, I think I don't see any more additional questions here. Then I'll shortly come back to our final summary. Where's my presentation? There it is. So our summary. We saw that how OpenAPC works. We are an open data project which collects and disseminates article-based APC data. And I also showed how transparency is a really very, very important point in our daily working in OpenAPC. we apply this transparency principle not only to the data and the APCs itself, but also to our enrichment, to our history, and to our software processing scripts. And I also showed how you can contribute to OpenAPC. It's really very easy. There's no red tape, no complicated data formats, no submission forms or something like that. You just submit our data to us via an email and an attached CSV file, and that's about it. And there's also no need for large data sets. More is better, of course, but every bit helps. If your institution doesn't publish that much, let's say only 5 or 10 articles a year, that's perfectly acceptable. And a final hint I want to give, we talked a bit about this complicated process of bridging the worlds between accounting and library metadata. And there might be a useful hint. If your institution operates an open access publishing fund or something like that, there are many universities and libraries doing that nowadays, then it's likely that they already have the data we could use. Because these publishing funds, they usually have an Excel or CSV file already floating around somewhere where the data is in the form we needed. A list of articles and article identifiers, DOIs, linked to paid APC amounts. Publishing funds, they usually have the data. So if your institution, if there's an open access publishing fund operating at your institution, that might be a good starting point. They might really have the data we could use. All right, I think this concludes it. Wow, 12 o'clock. Really great. if you're interested in our presentation, you can find it at this bit.ly link here. It's in a form of an XHTML file. So you can also go ahead and click all the links in this presentation if you want to reread them or are interested in more details. All right. Yeah. I think that's it. Andreas, do you want to say some final remarks?
Thank you very much, Christoph. So, and thank you for attending this webinar. We hope this was helpful for you and your work, for your daily work. Yeah, Christoph said the presentation are as soon as possible available. And if you have any further questions, please contact us at our email address. And yes, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very Goodbye. Much Andreas and Christoph, and thank you very much for being so good on your time. This is very very impressive. I will add a link to the presentation and a link to the recordings to the open air webinar page, so just be patient for a little bit and then you will see it appear there. So thank you very much, everybody, for attending. I hope we'll see you again soon at one of our other webinars. And you can expect one more email from me with an evaluation form, but that will also be probably early next week. So thank you very much.